Hello everyone, and welcome back to my KSP tutorial series in Kerbal Space Program 0.90 Beta. In this episode, I wanted to finish off this contract to explore the moon using an unmanned probe to land there and transmit data from the surface, but somebody in the comments mentioned that it would be a good idea to rescue this Kerbal, and I think that might be an interesting thing. I've never rescued a Kerbal without using the maneuver node system, which isn't unlocked yet. And I know in theory how to do it, and I'll explain in theory how to do it, but doing it in practice might be a significant challenge for me, so I think I'm going to go with that. We've got advance of 7,500, completion 30,000. It's going to cost more than 7,500 to actually launch this mission, I think. But, well, maybe we'll recover most of that, recovering the vessel. Okay, let's pick it up and I'll talk about what we need. Okay, so first of all, this is only possible because we've unlocked this probe core, and that will allow us to have stability assist while having an empty command pod on top, like so. And of course we're going to be having parachutes and all, but the key thing is really getting to the Kerbal, right? And here we get into the subject of transfers. A transfer is when you're in one orbit and you need to get to something in a totally different orbit. And so that's what a transfer is. As long as both orbits are orbiting the same body, in this case it'd be Kerbin, but it could be the Sun, it could be Kerbal, which is the Sun's name in the Kerbal Space Program. And so you could be talking about transfers between two planets, or you could be talking about a transfer between a spacecraft in orbit around Kerbin and a space station. Or between a spacecraft and the moon, and all of them are fundamentally the same. And so the calculation is the same way. There are many different kinds of transfers, but the one that you'll use most in Kerbal Space Program is called the Hohmann transfer. The Hohmann transfer is the type of transfer where the one end of your transfer orbit is touching your current orbit, and 180 degrees later, around the central body, in this case Kerbin, let's say, on the other side, you're going to be hitting your target. And so it's a tangent on both sides. Now, you don't have to have it like that. You could overshoot or do any number of other things like gravity assists and all that. There are many kinds of transfers. But the Hohmann transfer looks like this. It's a 180-degree arc between the two orbits. And the benefit of the Hohmann transfer is it's very efficient. In most cases, it's the most efficient transfer you can do. And it's fairly easy to calculate. And the thing you want to calculate most is the phase angle, which is the angle between your original orbit and the orbit of the target in order to make the transfer at the right time. So in the diagram that I am showing there, you will see that the target is in a higher orbit in that diagram. And in that case, we want it a little bit ahead of us so that when we get over to the other side, we will be hitting it right there, because the higher orbit is slower. I haven't really talked much about orbital dynamics yet, but lower orbits are faster, higher orbits are slower. And so if you are going to try and reach something in a higher orbit than yourself, you want it to be leading a bit. If you're going to hit something in a lower orbit than yourself, you're going to want it to be trailing a little bit because it's going faster. Okay, and we'll talk much more about that sort of thing. I'm not going to try and derive the Hohmann transfer, but you see the equation for the phase angle there. Pretty unique equation. Now, that's an approximation. That approximation works if the orbits are circular, if they're in the same plane, in other words, there's no inclination difference between them, and they're not very, and you know, you're not going to try anything really strange. So, circular and same inclination, let's just go with that. So yeah, that is the phase angle calculation. You can see R1 is the distance from the center of the central body to your first orbit, and then R2 is the distance from the center of the central body to the second orbit. Note that it's not the surface, it's the center of the planet or the Sun. So we have to calculate from there. Kerbin's radius, by the way, is 600 kilometers, so we're going to be using that a lot. Okay. So we've got that, but we don't really know what orbit we got to start out yet, so we're not going to be able to calculate that right now. So I'll show you how to calculate that once we get underway with the mission. But it's an interesting calculation. It's got that 1.5 power that it's raising the radiuses to and all that. So anyway, but we'll leave that for once we are up there. Now, I'm going to add some batteries to this because otherwise this is not going to have enough power and we don't have solar panels. I need RCS. We haven't unlocked RCS yet. RCS tanks. We haven't unlocked those yet. This is heavier. We don't need that much RCS. We really don't need this much RCS either. But this is the smallest tank. I probably need more than comes in this pod, which is only 10 units. So yeah, I guess I have to unlock this. Costs a bit. But we'll need it eventually anyway. Let me get two of these. Actually, it probably would be best to attach it once I've got the thing on the bottom, whatever. Probably a tank. Yeah. And get the angle snap on. That doesn't look good. Let's offset that. That looks better. And I don't need all of it, so I'm going to just empty it halfway. Not very efficient in terms of carrying fuel, but that's what I want to do right now. Okay, that looks like a start. What's our mass? 4.2 tons. I think we're gonna need more parachutes once this is, even when this is empty, it's gotta be 2.2 tons. So, yeah, let's slap two more parachutes on. And those could be offset as well. That's a little bit better. And then the RCS thrusters. Now the RCS thrusters are the way that you maneuver for docking mainly and for approaching small targets. And you'll need four of them around your center of mass. So here you see I've got this. This is the center of mass indicator. And I put them right at the center of mass if possible. Or you could put a set on top and a set on bottom to balance it out if for some reason you can't attach it at the center of mass because you got other stuff in the way. So you can set them aside, but you want them balanced across the center of mass so that they, when they do their thrust, they're not going to unbalance the vehicle. They're not going to start some rotation in one direction or another. And if they're on one side, you're going to end up with a rotation in one direction or another that you don't want. Okay, the RCS thrusters take the mod propellant fuel from here, and it doesn't matter that they're not attached to those tanks, they'll take them from anywhere on the vehicle really, even if it's in another stage, which is a little bit irritating sometimes. Okay, I think this is our main spacecraft, but maybe we want the luxury of a soft landing. Pretty luxurious to have landing legs on this thing. But after rescuing a Kerbal, maybe we want him to have a nice smooth ride down without worrying that he might end up tipping over and crashing. Oh no, that's not what I want to do. No, that's not what I want to do at all. Okay, so when it's like this, it's on the angle, so that's probably not the best place to put it. Let me put these like this and these like that. You don't technically have to worry about these being in line with those. It's not gonna block the thrusters or anything. I just like it for looks. Okay, that's better. Might be too much there. There we go. Just didn't want them sticking out as much as they were. That is our rescue pod. Yay! And now, the rest of the rocket. And we're just gonna put as much fuel as we can without breaking the 18-ton limit. Okay, come on. Again, I know how to do this in theory, but I haven't done it in practice, so I want as much margin as I can shove onto here. And that's basically it. I'm reasonably sure that this is enough delta V to get into orbit based on calculations from previous missions, right? We've done the calculations and we could get something like this even further. Though not all the way to the moon this time because we're carrying a lot more stuff on top, including the mod propellant. So, yep. Okay, I think we're ready to go. Make sure there's no Kerbal inside. Good. Trying to remember if I forgot anything. Look at all our parts. Anything suggestive? We're not really carrying any science. We just want to rescue a Kerbal. Okay. So we're calling this Rescue 1. Okay. Staging is a little bit wacky. But that's it. Let's launch. Let's launch. It's nighttime. Gotta time warp it a little bit. Oh, darn. Electric charges. No. Recover vessel. We absolutely need to have the maximum amount of electric charge, so let's time warp here. Okay. Now, let's see where Lindorf Krimen is. Forgot to check that. Okay, 99 kilometers. I think that's probably a 100 kilometer orbit right there. And that's what we'll estimate. Okay, so that's where he is. Gonna take a while if he's all the way over there. Let's get him a little bit closer to this side. But I still want to give myself some time to explain stuff, so I don't want him like right over us or anything. And right over us would be totally wrong. Let's say here. Okay. Okay, Rescue 1. Is it the most expensive craft I've done? Yeah, so far it's the most expensive craft I've done. And I don't want Jeb in. Okay, let's launch. But we're recovering the top parts, so it's alright. Okay, here we go in daylight. Looks like everything's in order. SAS on, throttle up, and launch. So since Lemdorf is in a 100 kilometer orbit, I think I'll go for 160 for myself. We need a little bit of a gap between our orbits so that it won't take too long to rendezvous with him. Remember, he's behind us right now, but he's going to be catching up because he's going to be in the lower orbit, which is the faster orbit. And so I want to get a good gap so that he can catch up quicker so we don't have to spend a lot of time in orbit waiting for him. And that's important because we can't replenish the electric charge. And basically this mission, I'm gonna bring this back down once the electric charge gets to like 100. Otherwise, we're not gonna be recovering the value of this. So even if we can't rescue Lemdorf, I want to bring the craft back instead of just leaving it to die in orbit. Let's bring notes up. Gotta write out the equation here just so we remember. So it's 180. 1 minus, and then nestled parentheses, R1 plus R2. R2 is always your target, by the way. Okay, divided by 2 R2. Okay, and all of that 2 to 1.5 power multiplied by 180. But stability assist is doing its thing, so much better than with the stay put, Nick. Okay. All right, what are we at now? Oops, still going up. It'd be tough to go into a lower orbit than Lemdorf. I mean, since the atmosphere is at 70, we'd have to be like 80 and he'd be at 100. Actually, he's not 100. He's got a eccentric orbit, unfortunately, which is not ideal for our little equation here. Looks like he's at a 90 by 100 sort of thing. So that's not great. Now, once you get good at calculating this stuff, you could do single tangent thing where you touch Lemdorf's orbit on one side, but then you go past it on the other side in order to slow down. But we're not going to do that this time. I do want to make sure our inclination isn't too far off. It looks like we're going too far south, so I'm going to point north a bit. Okay, that's about right. Oop, went too far. 170, alright. Now, remember our equation is for circular orbits, so I want to circularize this thing. Don't know how much fuel I'll have to spare, honestly. Our inclination with him is a little bit different. We can't target him right now. And later on in the game, when you unlock stuff, you're going to be able to target your, your target. But right now, I can't do that. Okay, for the sake of fuel, I'm going to go with the one tangent thing. But I'm going to show you how to calculate it from, let's do it honestly. Okay, so we're at 156 by 178, and if you average that out, what is it? Well, calculator. 156. I should be able to do this in my head, but 167. Okay, good enough for me. So, we're at 167. So, R1 is at 167 altitude, which is 767 in terms of the center of the planet. R2 is, we'll say 95, because he's got a 90 by 100. So 95, which means 695 from the center of the planet. 600 plus whatever the altitude is. Okay, and so what we want is calculator again. And so let's add the two together. Plus 695 equals that. Okay. And let me just put that down, because calculator sometimes leaves me without the numbers I want. And then we want 2 times R2, so 2 times equals, okay, so, divide by 1390 equals that, and then we need to take that to the 1.5 power. Okay, so how do I take things to, okay, to the 1.5. Okay, and now we need 1 minus that, so let me just put that number down so that I don't forget it, just in case it loses it for me. Okay, so yep. It will. I need to do 1 minus 1.0786, and then that times 180. Okay, that's our phase angle. Alright, so it is negative, which means we want, let's orient this the same way as the diagram. We want the target behind us, which is exactly what we've got, and we want him behind us by 14 degrees. Right now, Lemdorf is behind us by more than 14 degrees. So I'm going to reach for my protractor, and let's see now. Looks like about 35 degrees right now. So we're going to time warp and let him catch up to us. Ah, I can't do that with calculator up. So we want 14 degrees. So you'll do this with the planets as well, and we could show that, but right now we're just going to focus on Lemdorf, and we could do it with the moon. The moon's altitude above the surface, you just take that altitude. You'll notice 11,400,000 meters, which is 11,400 kilometers, and you add the 600 kilometers from the planet, it happens to be exactly 12,000 kilometers circular. So it's pretty easy to calculate stuff with the moon. and get exactly the phase angle. Happens to be the case that it'll be rising over the horizon exactly when you need to transfer anyway, as we mentioned in the previous episode. Now, with neither of our orbits being actually circular, this is just going to be an approximation when I should do this. And so we're going to have to fine-tune this quite a lot. Let's see, is that... That looks 14-ish. More like 17. And serious, we have to get to the Kerbal, I mean, so we can't just be like vague about this. Now, once you unlock the maneuver node system, it's a lot easier, of course. You don't have to bother. You'll be able to see exactly how far away you're going to be from him, but we don't have that system right now. Okay, so now we're going to do... Actually, it is going to be retroburn. Right way around, darn it. Okay, so now we need to be at this end on one, on the original orbit, and on the other end be touching Lendorf's orbit. So, gonna retroburn here. So, well, that's probably above his orbit, as we can see. Still gonna be pretty far away from him, I'm sure. But let's do this as tightly as possible. It looks pretty good. We've done our calculations, so I'm gonna get rid of Notepad. Now, let's make sure that we're in line with his orbit. And we need pretty good precision here. We seem to be above his orbit on this side, and so let's see where the orbits cross. Once we can see him in this view, we can target him, but that's not the end of the story, because we need to be within 10 kilometers. I think it'll be better once we get closer to him. Then we'll see what's really up. So you can see him catching up. And then if it really worked, didn't work. My estimations were too far off. He didn't catch up. Okay, but that's all right. So if this does happen, I'll show you what you have to do. Obviously, he needs to catch up more, and we've got to be slower on this part of our orbit because we've got to be higher. So we're going to leave that side up, but not all the way. We are going to bring our orbit down. Just a smidgen. We want him to catch up, but not too much. We don't want him to pass us. So yeah. The inaccuracy came because neither of our orbits was circular. So that's not a problem with most any of the bodies except for maybe the closest and furthest planets in the game when it comes to the game itself. All the planets are pretty much circular. The moon is circular. And so as long as you get in a circular orbit, you're pretty much all right. Now, inclination. So you see that there's a vertical gap between our orbits, and here it's closing in. Here we're pretty much in line with his orbit, and that's where we want to be. So it looks like we were lower back here, and we've got to be higher in front up here. So we want to lower our orbit in this direction, which means heading south. And it has to be done at the point where the orbits cross. Okay, Alright, so that's good. Let's go around one more time, and hopefully Lemdorf will have caught up. Will turning off SAS, yeah, maybe that'll help with the electric charge situation. Again, 100 charge is when I abort mission and come back down. Okay, this time Lemdorf's ahead of us. How far ahead is he visible here? Yeah. Let's see if we can target him. 30 kilometers. That's still very far. So now he's ahead of us, so I want to get an orbit that's tighter into the planet than his. There's also the possibility of doing radio burns, but I don't know if I'm going to need to do that here. Let's see if we're catching up to him. So 28.5. Yep, catching up to him. Okay, but I don't want to correct until we're on this side of the orbit, so I'm not gonna... If we pass him, that's fine. I need to get on this side of the orbit to correct it, otherwise things are gonna go wrong. It's the part where we're already touching his orbit that we want to do everything from. This is good enough, I think. Okay, he's behind us again. No, we were behind him, right. And also I want to do everything from this point because it's the bright side. That'll make rendezvous much easier. Okay, so 13 is not bad, by the way. But we can do better than that. And we'll need to, definitely before doing finer maneuvers, you'll want like 10. Now, our orbits seem to be, there's a gap here, so I want to see where our orbits cross if possible. Okay. So now, he's behind us, so I need to slow down, and that means getting into a higher orbit. Now, this is the target. We want the orbit view. And this time I'm going to use RCS. So I'm pressing R to activate RCS. I'm going to push H to thrust forward. It's the same as the regular thrust, except it's much more fine-tuned and it only happens when you're pressing the button. And of course that consumes the monopropellant fuel instead of the main fuel, which is why I was doing that. Pretty far away at this point. Sheesh. Maybe we didn't do enough. Yeah, we didn't do enough, darn it. We're sort of matching his orbit. Let's go further. We really only have one orbit left. Okay, that's within my 10 kilometer range now. Let's get further on. Okay, so now we're going to be doing the fine-tuning maneuvers. Once we're within 10 kilometers, we can start doing that. It's a little bit tricky from 10 kilometers. It's better when you're closer. Okay, we're closing in on periapsis. We better start. Okay, so target view. First thing we need to do is kill the relative velocity, which means we're going at a different speed than the target, and that speed gap is 39.1 kilometers, 30, not kilometers, meters per second, 39 meters per second here. And we want to get rid of that difference. But we only want to get rid of that difference when we're at our closest point with the target. But we also want to do things before we get into the dark, so I'm gonna just get rid of the difference. You see here I'm pointed at the target and I'm pushing H to push forward, and then I push J to move the little yellow cursor, which indicates my current path, to the left. So if I want to push that to the left, I use J. I use L to push it to the right, and I want to get lined up. And then I and K are up and down. But you don't want to overdo it. So as this thing will stray, I'm just going to let it do that. Gonna wait until we get as close as possible, and then we gotta recorrect. Okay, that was as close as possible. We started going up again. So I'm going to use main engine to get rid of this 19 meter per second gap. And then RCS. Pushing H, J. Normally with the maneuver node system, I'd get within 1 kilometer. So this is all very, very difficult from this distance. And it's because of the way the vector strays. Whoops, not what I wanted to do. And it's just a lot of iterations of doing the same thing. Might go without saying, but the less experienced you are, the slower you want to go during all this. You do not want to overdo it. Try to be patient. Patience is the main thing when it comes to rendezvousing with something in orbit. Especially in a close orbit like this, with something that doesn't have gravity. With the moon, obviously, it's easier because it's got its gravity. It'll pull you down and you don't have to worry too much about it. Okay, we are now within almost within 1 kilometer of Lendorf. Kind of get rid of this relative velocity again. Now that we're this close, the markers shouldn't stray from each other as much as they have been. Okay, we're getting close enough that we should probably slow down. I'm going to use RCS. I'm pushing N. N goes backwards. That's one of the big benefits of RCS. You don't have to turn around in order to slow down. With your main engine, you generally do have to turn around in order to decelerate. But I can just push N right now. And I still want to be lined up with Lendorf. Technically, we can take control over Lendorf right now and bring him in. As long as we're within 2 kilometers, we can take control over him, but I'd rather get him closer to the pod, because if there's anything I'm not good at, it's using the little EVA packs that they have. You can see it's all about keeping your prograde marker close to the target marker. We have plenty of mop down left. Hope it doesn't cause too much problem for our parachutes to have that much. But probably wouldn't. Okay, so now we have 0 meters per second with respect to the target. I'm pushing the square bracket. Either one will do because there's only two things to switch from, but they switch between objects in render distance. So here we are. We are with Lendorf. I'm pushing R to activate his EVA pack. Did I put the parachute over the capsule hatch? I put the parachute over the capsule hatch. That was stupid. Okay, well, let's see if this still works. I'm not good at this, so you'll forgive me for not trying to explain what I'm doing. I'm gonna switch back to the capsule and rotate it so that the covered hatch is on this side. Switch back to Lendorf. I don't know if it's going to work with the parachute over it. So it's WASD and then left shift and control, left control in order to control him. So I'm not doing a very good job. Oh, and of course Q and E to rotate. Okay, they let me put them in. That's amazing. In the future, definitely do not want to obstruct the hatch with the parachute. Bad idea. Okay, but Lemdorf is in. We've managed to do it without maneuver nodes. Amazing. And now what I'm going to do is take off SAS. We still got some electricity drain here. And, you know, I should have taken the advantage of having him outside. Maybe he could have done some science. I forgot all about that, darn it. Oh well. Yeah, missed opportunity there. But, well, we could, I'm thinking about whether to wait until the KSC is in, on the bright side. I don't know if we have enough electric charge for that. Yeah, that drains too much. We need to bring it down. Even in the dark. I should have put a little marker at the KSC. I can't see where it is right now. Once we get back, I'll have to do that first thing. Okay, I'm going to use RCS to do the retroburn. Pushing H, of course. Going to bring the periapsis to, well, from that apoapsis, probably around 30. 32 sounds fine. Maybe 31. Okay, that'll do. Alright, so unfortunately we gotta be landing on the dark side of the planet with no lights on board. Sorry about that, but we're running out of electric charge and I don't want to risk anything now. Okay, we are suborbital now. Probably overshooting our target. Let's see, can we spot the KSC anywhere in this dark night? Not particularly. Can't see what sort of terrain we're over. Could be dangerous. I think it's just gonna be water. I think I see the peninsula over here. We're not too far off from the KFC. We're a little bit past it, I think. Can't see even the slightest sign of it, though. Okay, parachutes. Landing gear down. Oh, wait, that's the KFC. We're not far off at all. We're in the water next to the KSC. Excellent. Okay, full parachute deployment. 5.5 meters per second. Should be safe, but I'll probably light the engine just before the surface so that we can slow down a little bit more. Okay, nice soft landing for Lemdorf. Let's recover this. And there you have it, a successful recovery of a Kerbal from orbit, 97.6% of the upper pod retrieved, so 7,866 funds for that, and no maneuver nodes, so that's how you do without maneuver nodes. Lemdorf got an experience point even, I don't know what he did, but okay. Yep, alright, so one thing I wanted to do was plant a flag near the Space Center so we can see it even if it's in the dark side of the planet. So let me quickly time warp to daylight. Okay, I'm gonna just launch the pod with Bill, let's say. No, Bob. No, it takes an engineer to put up a flag, right? Bill. Alright. So Bill will plant the flag. Okay, here we are, and Bill, EVA. I think we've done all the science from around here, but we need to plant a flag next to that flag, perhaps. Hopefully that's not ever going to be in the way of the other structures that we end up having around here. Somebody reminded me that we pushed shift to get these guys to run, something I had forgotten. Okay, hopefully around here. Oh, we can't plant flags? Aww. Or does it have to be somebody specific who plants flags? Well, let's get an EV report. Useless. Ah, oh, okay. Well, that's a bummer. Okay, get back in there and let's recover this. Okay, yeah, that's recovered. Got it. Whoa, he gained an experience point for that. That's crazy. Well, let's take a look at the astronaut complex. Yeah, Bill got experience for walking around. Flight at Kerbin, if you say so. You know what? Given that, let's see if maybe Bob can get experience for that. I want, you know, an experienced crew eventually. Yeah, let's do that quickly. Okay, Bob, I think there is some other science around here. Maybe you can go grab it. I think maybe further into the complex, I don't know. Okay, maybe something around here? EVA report? Yeah, report from VAB, okay. Keep that data. I think I'll walk him all the way back. Let's just recover him and recover the vessel separately. Okay, that's Bob gained the experience point, and I'm gonna recover this here. Okay, good. Alright, let's build a moon probe. Now the plan for this moon probe is that it's not going to be coming back, I don't think. But we're going to be carrying as much science as possible. So, Science Junior, goo containers. We're going to need a lot of battery power. We might end up hitting the limit on part count. We've got a 30 part limit there. Oh, that's an unfortunate. We don't have a very good nose cone, do we? I think it's just gonna have to be a blunt object. What's our mass? 3.4? That's not bad. Let me do the calculation here. I don't think we need anything else, do we? Oh yeah, to transmit the info back, we need an antenna. Maybe we should carry more goo containers. Nah, let me just... There we go. Alright, that looks better. Maybe shift them up a little bit. I don't like them interfering with the engine. Okay. So yeah, now let me calculate this out. Well, I'll bring out calculator. 3,100. So this is 3,100 delta V right here. Okay. I'd say we need 4,500 for orbit. We need, just to be safe, let's say 900 transfer to moon. 250 moon orbit. And I'd want at least 800, let's say 850 for moon landing. Okay, and you sum all that up and you get, well, that's 5,400 there, 1,100 here, so that is 6,500 total. So we've got 3,000, so we still need 3,500. Okay. And I'm being conservative at every step here. So let's just put as much fuel as possible and see how much we get. Okay, so that gives me 3,369 here. And we had 3,100 up here. We're pretty close, especially since I'm keeping it conservative. I'm rounding all the numbers down. But I could afford to slip in another tank here. And we'll call that good. So this is going to be our Moon Explorer. One. And I'm going to wait until the next episode to launch this and see if it works out and fulfill that contract, alright? So with that, thank you for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please do press like. If you have any comments or suggestions, please leave them in the comment section below. And I'll see you next time.